Hello everyone, I'm Matt, and welcome to part 2 of my tutorial building tutorial. In the previous lesson, I showed you how to build the basic foundation of this studio lighting setup tutorial. In this lesson, we'll finish things off by adding some more functionality, including triggers to automatically progress between steps, a restart button, and adding some personality. So let's get to it! So right now I have to manually move through each step by hitting this next button on the controller. That means I'm trusting the user to know they've done the right thing before continuing, rather than confirming that they did the right thing before continuing. In game development, this is known as a trigger. And we can do the same thing here in Maya by using a trigger template. The first place I'll want to trigger is in step 2, when I ask the user to create a plane. For that, I'm going to duplicate the event listener template and rename it Stage 2 Create Plane Trigger. Then plug it into the end of my Stage 2 chain. Now in the expression editor, I'll rename number 1 to match the new script name, just like we did with all the others. Number 2 here determines what to look out for, the trigger event, so to speak, while number 3 determines what actually happens once the trigger event is detected. So thinking about how I want this to work, whenever the user creates a new object, I'm going to want to check if it was a polygon plane. If it was, then I want to move to the next step automatically. Now, so far we've managed to get this far strictly by filling in values into templates, but this is the part where some familiarity with Python or even just scripting in general will come in handy. Starting with number 2, I need to find an appropriate trigger event. As you can see, I've left a link here that leads to a list of them. So I'll just copy and paste that into a browser window. Then go to the List Events section. Looking at the various event types, the one that jumps out at me is DAG object created. After all, a polygon plane is a DAG object. So let's use that. Now the tutorial will progress when a new DAG object is created. And if I test it, you'll see that creating a poly plane does indeed advance the step. However, at the moment, I haven't limited this to a polyplane. In fact, any polygon I create will advance the step. To ensure the user creates the right kind of polygon, I'll need to check for it using the ls, aka list, command. To show you how this works, I'll open the script editor, which is like a scratch pad where I can test code before putting it into my actual script. Then I'll use the command cmds.ls pplane1 to list all objects named pplane1 and store the result in a variable named plane1exists. Then I'll just print plane1exists. And now if I run this, you can see that it shows an empty list since plane 1 doesn't exist. But when it does, then it appears in the output. Of course, I only want to act if the plane does exist, so I'll check for it with a conditional if statement and indent my print statement under it. Now my script only prints if the plane exists. If it doesn't, then nothing gets printed at all. And that's all there is to it. So I'll just copy and paste that into my script. Under number 3. Then remove the print statement and indent the code to advance the step underneath it. And now if I run stage 2 again, the tutorial only proceeds when a plane is created. So that's one trigger down. I'll show you the process one more time for stage 3's trigger. Like before, I need to choose the type of trigger I want. This time, I'll go with an attribute change trigger, since the step is all about changing the size of the polyplane. So I'll duplicate it, rename it, and plug it into the end of my stage 3 chain. Then in the expression editor, I'll rename number 1 as always. Now, this type of trigger doesn't ask for a trigger event, but rather for a trigger attribute. In this case, I know I want pplane1.scale. For the trigger itself, I want to check that my plane is 1700 by 1 by 1700. So I'll open the script editor again, then grab its scale using a getAdder, aka getAttribute command, and store it in a variable called planeScale. Then to test it, I'll print the value. The result correctly shows me that plane 1 is currently at the default 111 scale. Also notice the result is encased in these square brackets. This is just because this getAdder command returns a list of one item. However, if I want the value itself, not the list, I can put square bracket 0 at the end to grab the first and only item. Then it's just a simple matter of making sure it matches the value 1700 1 1700. And like the step 2 example, this if statement will only print when the plane's scale values are exactly right. Then I'll copy and paste that code into my step 3 trigger like so. And now if I restart, I have 2 working steps. I won't go through every trigger in detail like this, but feel free to open the example in the description to see how the rest of them work. They're all basically some variation of this same pattern of waiting for an event or attribute change, checking a value, and then moving to the next stage if that value is correct. For now, let's move on to the restart step button. So half of ensuring a good interactive experience is confirming to the user when they get something right. The other half is allowing them to gracefully recover when they do something wrong. That might entail something a bit different for each individual step. In this particular case, we'll want to delete any accidental geometry the user might create before the plane. I'll do this using a stage setup node, which sets up each stage before it starts. As always, I'll begin by duplicating the template and renaming it. Then, because it's a setup node, we'll plug it into the beginning of my stage 2 script chain. In the expression editor, I'll rename number 1 to match the new node name, and leave number 2 alone. This basically lets me set what camera to look through at the start of each stage. But in this case, we only have one camera anyway. Now I need to figure out what I want to do when the user restarts the step, which is pretty simple. I'll just delete all geometry objects. So for that, I'm going to use the ls command again to build a list of everything I want to delete. Thankfully, ls has a handy transform flag, which will include not just poly objects, but curves, type, basically a whole host of things a user might make by mistake. But I'm also going to filter on only things that are visible to avoid deleting my cameras with it, since those have transforms as well. Then it's just a matter of deleting all the objects in my list. So now this code is ready to get copied and pasted into my setup script. And then I just need to remember to go back to my update controller script and actually enable the reset step button for this stage. And now if I run the tutorial again, you'll see I have a functional restart button on step one. Just like the triggers, I won't go through creating every single restart button, but feel free to have a look at the example file below to see how I did them all. At this point, you have all the skills to put together a very functional interactive tutorial. But to go the extra mile, why not add a bit of a story element to make it more fun and friendly, both for the student as well as for you, the teacher, too? Like the existing onboarding tutorials, I'll do that by adding our resident in-product tutor, MayaBot. This is a pretty typical HIK rig, which you can pose with these controls using the tools in the toolbox. I'll go ahead and use them to pose a character for each stage that I want it to appear on, starting with my stage 1 pose. And once I'm happy with it, I'll duplicate just MayaBot's geometry and rename it Stage 1 Still, which leaves me with an almost wax sculpture-like copy of MayaBot ready for Stage 1. Then I'll just go ahead and pose it for the other steps as well. So now I've got a bunch of different MayaBot stills for various stages in my tutorial. But the question remains, how do I swap between them at the right time? For that, I'll use the time slider. Basically, I'll bookmark several different times on the time slider, then keyframe the visibility of each of these stills to line up with those bookmarks, so that when I jump from one to the next, the right still will appear. So starting at frame 1, I'll create a new bookmark and call it Time Slider Bookmark 1, and leave the color and frame range at the defaults. You can see my bookmark down here. Next, I'll just keyframe my Stage 1 still's visibility there so that it shows up. Then I'll create a second bookmark, this time spaced out to frame 6. I always recommend spacing them out a bit like this just to leave room for insertions later. Maybe choose a different color this time just for some differentiation. Then I'll hide the still on this frame and keyframe the visibility. And now if I scrub between the two, I can show and hide MayaBot. I just need this to happen automatically between stages, which is thankfully pretty easy. First, I'll use the search bar in selection mode to find Time Slider Bookmark 1. Then add it to the node editor using this plus button. Then I can just plug the bookmark's name output into Stage 0's Time Slider Bookmark input. And that's it! Then I'll repeat the same thing for the second bookmark. And now if I run the tutorial, you'll see that the Time Slider jumps to the right bookmark at the beginning of each stage. Then it's just a matter of repeating this process for our other stills as well. Note that if you want to get really fancy, you don't have to do these as just single frame stills. Alternatively, you could bookmark a range of frames, then play entire animations at each step instead. The choice is up to you. And here's a look at our finished tutorial in all its glory. What, you're still here? Okay, well, here's a few tips and tricks I couldn't fit elsewhere into this tutorial, starting with UI relative placement. Back in the previous video, I showed you how to manually position a text overlay relative to the various cardinal points on the main Maya window. But one thing I didn't mention is that you can also place it relative to a specific button or window in the UI. To do that, just put the UI component name in the rel2 variable. How do you get the UI component's name? Well, that part is a little trickier. The most straightforward way is by running the command shown here. This prints a massive list of all the controls currently on screen that you can see in the script editor. What I tend to do is copy and paste this list into a text editor like Atom, then search for the component I'm looking for. Some of these are pretty obvious, like the Move and Rotate tools, which are very clearly named. In the case of step 2, I can look for Shelf to find the shelf buttons. In particular, I'm interested in the 6th button. So I'll put that into my rel2 variable. Then I'll just change the X and Y offsets back to 0, 0. And now if I restart the stage, you'll see the overlay appears right on top of the left corner of the playing button. Then I just need to offset it a small amount relative to there. And voila! Now the beauty of this is that even if I move the shelf elsewhere, refreshing the step will cause the overlay to follow it around. There are some buttons with strange, non-obvious names though, so you might need to experiment to find the exact one you're looking for. Next, there might be times you want to automate something at the beginning of a step. Maybe you want to make sure the outliner or channel box is open, or maybe you want to create some object for the user. You can set up automations like this using a stage setup template, the same one you used earlier to program the restart button functionality. This is where Python knowledge is really going to help you out, since the possibilities of what you can do here is almost endless. But you can get help using an age-old trick from Maya's early days. If I open the script editor and turn on echo all commands, then start clicking around the UI, notice that the script editor shows me exactly what commands it's executing behind the scenes. In fact, if I read through the output and copy and paste the right command down here, I can get the exact same effect. Then it's just a matter of moving that command into my tutorial if I want. Just remember that these commands are typically in MEL, so you'll need to convert to a Python equivalent either by referencing the help system or just by Googling. And finally, what's the best way to share your tutorial with others once you've finished it? First, I recommend using the archive scene command here to bundle up the tutorial file with all its dependencies, like textures, references, and so on. Once you have your zip file, you can take it to the Aereo website and create a tutorial page for it. Here you can give it a name, attach your zip file, and tag it as an interactive tutorial, so that the entire community can benefit. Not to mention your username will be attached to it forever too. So that just about does it. Now all that's left is to try making your own interactive tutorial about whatever subject you want. I hope to see you sharing your knowledge up in the area soon.